Guide to Islamic Finance. Part 4. Compiled by Hussein Fahmy. Conversely, if the sale is without any condition, but one of the two parties has promised to do something separately, then the sale cannot be held to be contingent or conditional with fulfilling of the promise. It will take effect irrespective of whether or not the promisor fulfills his promise. Even if the promisor backs out of his promise, the sale will remain effective. The most the promisee can do is to compel the promisor through court of law to fulfill his promise, and if the promisor is unable to fulfill the promise, the promisee can claim actual damages he has suffered because of the default. This makes it clear that a separate and independent promise to purchase does not render the original contract conditional or contingent. Therefore, it can be enforced. On the basis of this analysis, diminishing musharaka may be used for home financing with following conditions. A. The agreement of joint purchase, leasing and selling different units of the share of the financier should not be tied up together in one single contract. However, the joint purchase and the contract of lease may be joined in one document whereby the financier agrees to lease his share, after joint purchase, to the client. This is allowed because, as explained in the relevant chapter, ijara can be effected for a future date. At the same time, the client may sign one-sided promise to purchase different units of the share of the financier periodically, and the financier may undertake that when the client will purchase a unit of his share, the rent of the remaining units will be reduced accordingly. B. At the time of the purchase of each unit, sale must be effected by the exchange of offer and acceptance at that particular date. C. It will be preferable that the purchase of different units by the client is effected on the basis of the market value of the house as prevalent on the date of purchase of that unit, but it is also permissible that a particular price is agreed in the promise of purchase signed by the client. Diminishing musharaka for carrying business of services. The second example given above for diminishing musharaka is the joint purchase of a taxi run for earning income by using it as a hired vehicle. This arrangement consists of the following ingredients. A. Creating joint ownership in a taxi in the form of shirkat al-milk. As already stated, this is allowed in Sharia. B. Musharaka in the income generated through the services of the taxi. It is also allowed as mentioned earlier in this chapter. C. Purchase of different units of the share of the financier by the client. This is again subject to the conditions already detailed in the case of home financing. However, there is a slight difference between home financing and the arrangement suggested in this second example. The taxi, when used as a hired vehicle, normally depreciates in value over time. Therefore, depreciation in the value of the taxi must be kept in mind while determining the price of different units of the share of the financier. Diminishing musharaka in trade. The third example of diminishing musharaka as given above is that the financier contributes 60% of the capital for launching a business of ready-made garments, for example. This arrangement is composed of two ingredients only. 1. In the first place, the arrangement is simply a musharaka whereby two partners invest different amounts of capital in a joint enterprise. This is obviously permissible subject to the conditions of musharaka already spelled out earlier in this chapter. 2. Purchase of different units of the share of the financier by the client. This may be in the form of a separate and independent promise by the client. The requirements of Sharia regarding this promise are the same as explained in the case of house financing, with one very important difference. Here the price of units of the financier cannot be fixed in the promise to purchase, because if the price is fixed beforehand at the time of entering into musharaka, it will practically mean that the client has insured the principal invested by the financier with or without profit, which is strictly prohibited in the case of musharaka. Therefore, there are two options for the financier about fixing the price of his units to be purchased by the client. One option is that he agrees to sell the units on the basis of valuation of the business at the time of the purchase of each unit. If the value of the business has increased, the price will be higher, and if it has decreased, the price will be less. Such valuation may be carried out in accordance with the recognized principles through the experts, whose identity may be agreed upon between the parties when the promise is signed. The second option is that the financier allows the client to sell these units to anybody else at whatever price he can, but at the same time he offers a specific price to the client, meaning thereby that if he finds a purchaser of that unit at a higher price, he may sell it to him. But if he wants to sell it to the financier, the latter will be agreeable to purchase it at the price fixed by him beforehand. Although both these options are available according to the principles of Sharia, the second option does not seem to be feasible for the financier, because it would lead to injecting new partners in the Musharaka, which will disturb the whole arrangement and defeat the purpose of diminishing Musharaka, in which the financier wants to get his money back within a specified period. Therefore, in order to implement the objective of diminishing Musharaka, only the first option is practical. Uses: all purchase of fixed assets, home financing, plant and factory financing, car, transport financing, project financing of fixed assets, Murabaha. Murabaha is one of the most commonly used modes of financing by Islamic banks and financial institutions. Definition: Murabaha is a particular kind of sale where the seller expressly mentions the cost of the sold commodity he has incurred, and sells it to another person by adding some profit thereon. Thus, Murabaha is not a loan given on interest, it is a sale of a commodity for cash, deferred price. The Bay'i Murabaha involves purchase of a commodity by a bank on behalf of client and its resale to the latter on cost plus profit basis. Under this arrangement, the bank discloses its cost and profit margin to the client. In other words, rather than advancing money to a borrower, which is how the system would work in a conventional banking agreement, the bank will buy the goods from a third party and sell those goods onto the customer for a pre-agreed price. Murabaha is a mode of financing as old as Musharaka. Today in Islamic banks world, over 66% of all investment transactions are through Murabaha. Difference between Murabaha and sale. A simple sale in Arabic is called Muzawama, a bargaining sale without disclosing or referring to what the cost price is. However, when the cost price is disclosed to the client, it is called Murabaha. A simple Murabaha is one where there is cash payment, and Murabaha Muajjal is one on deferred payment basis. Arguments against Murabaha. An argument that arises in Murabaha is that profit or interest both are the same, and Murabaha financing is the same as conventional banking. Islamic scholars, however, argue that in several respects a Murabaha financing structure is quite different to an overdraft organized along conventional lines, and the former offers several benefits to the bank and its customers. Depositors are made to share in profits of the bank as a result of this financing. The basic difference is, however, the act or the contract which covers the Islamic conditions. If the contract has interest element, then it will be void. Basic rules for Murabaha. Following are the rules governing a Murabaha transaction. 1. The subject of sale must exist at the time of the sale. Thus, anything that may not exist at the time of sale cannot be sold, and its non-existence makes the contract void. 2. The subject matter should be in the ownership of the seller at the time of sale. If he sells something that he has not acquired himself, then the sale becomes void. 3. The subject of sale must be in physical or constructive possession of the seller when he sells it to another person. Constructive possession means a situation where the possessor has not taken physical delivery of the commodity, yet it has come into his control and all rights and liabilities of the commodity are passed on to him, including the risk of its destruction. 4. The sale must be instant and absolute. Thus, a sale attributed to a future date or a sale contingent on a future event is void. For example, A tells B on 1st January that he will sell his car on 1st February to B, the sale is void because it is attributed to a future date. 5. The subject matter should be a property having value. Thus, a good having no value cannot be sold or purchased. 6. The subject of sale should not be a thing used for an un-Islamic purpose. 7. The subject of sale must be specifically known and identified to the buyer. For example, an owner of an apartment building says to B that he will sell an apartment to B. Now the sale is void because the apartment to be sold is not specifically mentioned or pointed to the buyer. 8. The delivery of the sold commodity to the buyer must be certain and should not depend on a contingency or chance. 9. The certainty of price is a necessary condition for the validity of the sale. If the price is uncertain, the sale is void. 10. The sale must be unconditional. A conditional sale is invalid unless the condition is recognized as a part of the transaction according to the usage of the trade. Step-by-step Murabaha financing. 1. The client and the institution sign an overall agreement whereby the institution promises to sell and the client promises to buy the commodity from time to time on an agreed ratio of profit added to the cost. This agreement may specify the limit up to which the facility may be availed. 2. An agency agreement is signed by both parties in which the institution appoints the client as his agent for purchasing the commodity on its behalf. 3. The client purchases the commodity on behalf of the institution and takes possession as the agent of the institution. 4. The client informs the institution that it has purchased the commodity and simultaneously makes an offer to purchase it from the institution. 5. The institution accepts the offer and the sale is concluded whereby ownership as well as risk is transferred to the client. All the above conditions are necessary to effect a valid Murabaha. If the institution purchases the commodity directly from the supplier, it does not need any agency agreement. The most essential element of the transaction is that the commodity must remain in the risk of the institution during the period between the third and the fifth stage. The above is the only way by which this transaction is distinguished from an ordinary interest-based transaction. Issues in Murabaha. Following are some of the issues in Murabaha financing. 1. Securities against Murabaha. Payments coming from the sale are receivables and for this, the client may be asked to furnish a security. It can be in the form of a mortgage or hypothecation or some kind of lien or charge. 2. Guaranteeing the Murabaha. The seller can ask the client to furnish a third-party guarantee. In case of default on payment, the seller may have recourse to the guarantor who will be liable to pay the amount guaranteed to him. There are two issues relating to this. A. The guarantor cannot charge a fee from the original client. The reason being that a person charging a fee for advancing a loan comes under the definition of RIBA. B. However, the guarantor can charge for any documentation expenses. 3. Penalty of default. Another issue with Murabaha is that if the client defaults in payment of the price at the due date, the price cannot be changed nor can penalty fees be charged. In order to deal with dishonest clients who default in payment deliberately, they should be made liable to pay compensation to the Islamic bank for the loss suffered on account of default. However, these should be made subject to the following conditions. A. The defaulter may be given a grace period of at least 1 month. B. If it is proven beyond doubt that the client is defaulting without valid excuse, then compensation can be demanded. 4. Rollover in Murabaha. Murabaha transaction cannot be rolled over for a further period as the old contract ends. It should be understood that Murabaha is not a loan, rather the sale of a commodity, which is deferred to a specific date. Once this commodity is sold, its ownership transfers from the bank to the client and it is therefore no more a property of the seller. Now what the seller can claim is only the agreed price and therefore there is no question of effecting another sale on the same commodity between the same parties. 5. Rebate on earlier payments. Sometimes the debtors want to pay early to get discounts. However, in Islam, majority of Muslim scholars including the major schools of thought consider this to be un-Islamic. However, if the Islamic bank or financial institution gives somebody a rebate on its own, it is not objectionable, especially if the client is needy. 6. Calculation of cost in Murabaha. The Murabaha can only be affected when the seller can ascertain the exact cost he has incurred in acquiring the commodity he wants to sell. If the exact cost cannot be ascertained, then Murabaha cannot take place. In this case, the sale will take place as Musawama, that is, sale without reference to cost. 7. Subject matter of the sale. All commodities cannot be the subject matter in Murabaha because certain requirements need to be fulfilled. The shares of a lawful company can be sold or purchased on Murabaha basis because, according to the principles of Islam, the shares represent ownership into assets of the company provided all other basic conditions of the transaction are fulfilled. A buyback arrangement or selling without taking their possession is not allowed at all. Murabaha is not possible on things that cannot become the subject of sale. For example, Murabaha is not possible in exchange of currencies. Basic mistakes in Murabaha financing. Some basic mistakes that can be made and practical implications of the concept are as follows. 1. The most common mistake is to assume that Murabaha can be used for all types of transactions and financing. This mode can only be used when a commodity is to be purchased by the customer. If funds are required for some other purpose, Murabaha cannot be used. 2. The document is signed for obtaining funds for a specific commodity, and therefore it is important to study the subject matter of the Murabaha. 3. In some cases, the sale of commodity to the client is effected before the commodity is acquired from the supplier. This occurs when the various stages of the Murabaha are skipped and the documents are signed all together. It is to be remembered that Murabaha is a package of different contracts, and they come into play one after another at their respective stages. 4. It is observed in some financial institutions that Murabaha is applied on already purchased commodities, which is not allowed in Sharia and can be affected on not yet purchased commodities. Uses of Murabaha. Murabaha can be used in following conditions: short, medium, long-term finance for raw material, inventory, equipment, asset financing, import financing, export financing, pre-shipment, consumer goods financing, home financing, vehicle financing, land financing, shop financing, PC financing, tour package financing, education package financing, all other services that can be sold in the form of package, that is, services like education, medical, etc., as a package. Securitization of Murabaha agreement, certificate, is allowed at par value only. Otherwise, certain rules of Islamic finance must be met. Bay'i Mu'ajjal. Bay'i Mu'ajjal is the Arabic acronym for sale on deferred payment basis. The deferred payment becomes a loan payable by the buyer in a lump sum or installment, as agreed between the two parties. In Bay'i Mu'ajjal, all those items can be sold on deferred payment basis which come under the definition of capital, where quality does not make a difference but the intrinsic value does. Those assets do not come under definition of capital, where quality can be compensated for by the price, and Sharia scholars have an ijma, consensus, that demanding a high price in deferred payment in such a case is permissible. Conditions for Bay'i Mu'ajjal. 1. The price to be paid must be agreed and fixed at the time of the deal. It may include any amount of profit without qualms about riba. 2. Complete, total possession of the object in question must be given to the buyer, while the deferred price is to be treated as debt against him. 3. Once the price is fixed, it cannot be decreased in case of earlier payment, nor can it be increased in case of default. 4. In order to secure payment of price, the seller may ask the buyer to furnish a security either in the form of mortgage or in the form of an item. 5. If the commodity is sold on installments, the seller may put a condition on the buyer that if he fails to pay any installment on its due date, the remaining installments will become due immediately. Glossary. Rabbus Salam, buyer. Muslam Aleikh, seller. Ras el Mal, cash price. Muslim Fakh, purchased commodity. This mode of financing can be used by the modern banks and financial institutions, especially to finance the agricultural sector. Insulum. The seller undertakes to supply specific goods to the buyer at a future date in exchange of an advanced price fully paid at spot. The price is in cash, but the supply of purchased goods is deferred. Purpose of use. To meet the need of small farmers who need money to grow their crops and to feed their family up to the time of harvest. When Allah declared Riba Haram, the farmers could not take usurious loans. Therefore, noble profit allowed them to sell their agricultural products in advance. To meet the need of traders for import and export business. Under Salam, it is allowed for them that they sell the goods in advance so that after receiving their cash price, they can easily undertake the aforesaid business. Salam is beneficial to the seller because he received the price in advance, and it was beneficial to the buyer also because normally the price in Salam is lower than the price in spot sales. The permissibility of Salam is an exception to the general rule that prohibits forward sale, and therefore it is subject to strict conditions, which are as follows. Conditions of Salam. 1. It is necessary for the validity of Salam that the buyer pays the price in full to the seller at the time of effecting the sale. In the absence of full payment, it will be tantamount to sale of a debt against a debt, which is expressly prohibited by the noble prophet. Moreover, the basic wisdom for allowing Salam is to fulfill the instant need of the seller. If it's not paid in full, the basic purpose will not be achieved. 2. Only those goods can be sold through a Salam contract in which the quantity and quality can be exactly specified. Example. Precious stones cannot be sold on the basis of Salam because each stone differ in quality, size, weight, and their exact specification is not possible. 3. Salam cannot be affected on a particular commodity or on a product of a particular field or farm. Example. Supply of wheat of a particular field or the fruit of a particular tree, since there is a possibility that the crop is destroyed before delivery, and given such possibility, the delivery remains uncertain. 4. All details in respect to quality of goods sold must be expressly specified, leaving no ambiguity, which may lead to a dispute. 5. It is necessary that the quantity of the commodity is agreed upon in absolute terms. It should be measured or weighed in its usual measure only, meaning what is normally weighed cannot be quantified and vice versa. 6. The exact date and place of delivery must be specified in the contract. 7. Salam cannot be affected in respect of things which must be delivered at spot. 8. The commodity for Salam contract should remain in the market right from the day of contract up to the date of delivery, or at least till the date of delivery. 9. The time of delivery should be at least 15 days or 1 month from the date of agreement. Price in Salam is generally lower than the price in spot sale. The period should be long enough to affect prices. But Hanafi fiqh did not specify any minimum period for the validity of Salam. It is all right to have an earlier date of delivery if the seller consents to it. 10. Since price in Salam is generally lower than the price in spot sale, the difference in the two prices may be a valid profit for the bank. 11. A security in the form of a guarantee, mortgage or hypothecation may be required for a Salam in order to ensure that the seller delivers. 12. The seller at the time of delivery delivers commodities and not money to the buyer, who would have to establish a special cell for dealing in commodities. Benefits. There are two ways of benefiting from the contract of Salam. 1. After purchasing a commodity by way of Salam, the financial institution can sell it through a parallel contract of Salam for the same date of delivery. The period of Salam in the second parallel contract is shorter and the price is higher than the first contract. The difference between the two prices shall be the profit earned by the institution. The shorter the period of Salam, the higher the price and the greater the profit. In this way, institutions can manage their short-term financing portfolios. 2. The institution can obtain a promise to purchase from a third party. This promise should be unilateral from the expected buyer. The buyer does not have to pay the price in advance. When the institution receives the commodity, it can sell it at a predetermined price to a third party according to the terms of the promise. Parallelism. 1. In an arrangement of parallelism, there must be two different and independent contracts, one where the bank is a buyer and the other in which it is a seller. The two contracts cannot be tied up and performance of one should not be contingent on the other. For example, if A has purchased from B 1,000 bags of wheat by way of salam to be delivered on the 31st of December, A can contract a parallel salam with C to deliver to him 1,000 bags of wheat on the 31st of December. But while contracting parallel salam with C, the delivery of wheat to C cannot be conditioned with taking delivery from B. Therefore, even if B did not deliver wheat on the 31st of December, A is duty-bound to deliver 1,000 bags of wheat to C. He can seek whatever recourse he has against B, but he cannot rid himself from his liability to deliver wheat to C. Similarly, if B has delivered defective goods, which do not conform to the agreed specifications, A is still obligated to deliver the goods to C according to the specifications agreed with him. 2. A salam arrangement cannot be used as a buyback facility where the seller in the first contract is also the purchaser in the second. Even if the purchaser in the second contract is a separate legal entity, but owned by the seller in the first contract, it would not tantamount to a valid parallel salam agreement. For example, A has purchased 1,000 bags of wheat by way of salam from B, a joint stock company. B has a subsidiary C, which is a separate legal entity but is fully owned by B. A cannot contract the parallel salam with C. However, if C is not wholly owned by B, A can contract parallel salam with it, even if some shareholders are common between B and C. Istisna. Istisna is a sale transaction where a commodity is transacted before it comes into existence. It is an order to a manufacturer to manufacture a specific commodity for the purchaser. The manufacturer uses his own material to manufacture the required goods. In istisna, price must be fixed with consent of all parties involved. All other necessary specifications of the commodity must also be fully settled. Cancellation of contract. After giving prior notice, either party can cancel the contract before the manufacturing party has begun its work. Once the work starts, the contract cannot be cancelled unilaterally. Difference between istisna and salam. Istisna salam. 1. The subject on which transaction of istisna is based, is always a thing which needs to be manufactured. The subject can be anything that need manufacturing or not. 2. The price in istisna does not necessarily need to be paid in full in advance. It is not even necessary to pay. The price has to be paid in advance the full price at delivery. It can be deferred to any time according to the agreement of the parties. The payment may also be made in installments. 3. The time of delivery does not have to be fixed in istisna. The time of delivery is an essential part of the sale. 4. The contract can be cancelled before the manufacturer starts the work. The contract cannot be cancelled unilaterally. Difference between istisna and ijara. Istisna ijara. 1. The manufacturer either uses his own material and if it is not available with him, obtains it to make the ordered goods. The material is provided by the customer and the manufacturer uses only his labor and skill, meaning that his services will be hired for a specified fee paid to him. 2. The purchaser has a right to reject the goods after inspection as Sharia permits somebody who purchases a thing not seen by him to cancel the sale after seeing it. The right of rejection only exists if the goods do not conform to the specifications agreed upon between the parties at the time of contract. Right of rejection of goods after inspection does not exist. Time of delivery. As pointed out earlier, it is not necessary in istisna that the time of delivery is fixed. However, the purchaser may fix a maximum time for delivery, which means that if the manufacturer delays the delivery after the appointed time, he will not be bound to accept the goods and to pay the price. In order to ensure that the goods will be delivered within the specified period, some modern agreements of this nature contain a penal clause to the effect that in case the manufacturer delays the delivery after the appointed time, he shall be liable to a penalty which shall be calculated on a daily basis. Can such a penal clause be inserted in a contract of istisna according to Sharia? Although the classical jurists seem to be silent about this question while they discuss the contract of istisna, yet they have allowed a similar condition in the case of ijara. They say that if a person hires the services of a person to tailor his clothes, the fee may be variable according to the time of delivery. The hirer may say that he will pay 100/ in case the tailor prepares the clothes within 1 day and 80/ in case he prepares them after 2 days. On the same analogy, the price in istisna may be tied up with the time of delivery, and it will be permissible if it is agreed between the parties that in the case of delay in delivery, the price shall be reduced by a specified amount per day. Istisna as a mode of financing. Istisna may be used to provide financing for house financing. If the client owns a land and seeks financing for the construction of a house, the financier may undertake to construct the house on the basis of an istisna. If the client does not own the land and wants to purchase that too, the financier can provide him with a constructed house on a specified piece of land. The financier does not have to construct the house himself. He can either enter into a parallel istisna with a third party or hire the services of a contractor, other than the client. He must calculate his cost and fix the price of istisna with his client that allows him to make a reasonable profit over his cost. The payment of installments by the client may start right from the day when the contract of istisna is signed by the parties. In order to secure payment of installments, the title deeds of the house or land, or any other property of the client may be kept by the financier as a security until the last installment is paid by the client. The financier will be responsible to strictly conform to the specifications in the agreement for the construction of the house. The cost of correcting any discrepancy would have to be borne by him. Istisna may also be used for similar projects like installation of an air conditioner plant in the client's factory, building a bridge or a highway. The modern bought, buy, operate and transfer agreements may be formalized through an istisna agreement as well. So, if the government wants to build a highway, it may enter into an istisna contract with the builder. The price of istisna may be the right of the builder to operate the highway and collect tolls for a specific period. Uses of istisna. Home financing. Financing of plant, factory, building. Booking of apartments. Bot arrangements. Construction of buildings and plants. Istijra. Istijra means purchasing goods time to time in different quantities. In Islamic jurisprudence, istijra is an agreement where a buyer purchases something from time to time, each time there is no offer or acceptance or bargain. There is one master agreement where all terms and conditions are finalized. There are two types of istijra, whereby the price is determined after all transactions of purchase are complete, whereby the price is determined in advance but the purchase is executed from time to time. The first kind is relevant with the Islamic mode of financing. This kind is permissible with certain conditions. 1. In the case where the seller discloses the price of goods at the time of each transaction, the sale becomes valid only when the buyer possesses the goods. The amount is paid after all transactions have been completed. 2. If the seller does not disclose each and every time to the buyer the price of the subject matter, but the contractors know that it is being sold on market value and the market value is specified and determined in such a manner that it does not vary and it does not lead to differences of the contractors. 3. If at the time of possession, the price of subject matter was unknown or contractors agree that whatever the price shall be, the sale will be executed. However, if there is significant difference in the market price and the agreed price, it may cause conflict. In such a case, at the time of possession, the sale will not be valid. However, at the time of settlement of the payment, the sale will be valid. The validity will relate to the time of possession. Therefore, the ownership of the buyer in the subject matter will be proved from the time of possession. After the payment of price, the buyer's usage of the subject matter will be valid from the time of the possession. As far as the use of istijara in Islamic banks is concerned, at present they are involved in four kinds of activities, namely murabaha, ijara, mudraba, and musharaka. Out of these four, the concept of istijara can be applied to only the first three cases, due to the reason that istijara cannot be applied to borrowers of the bank. However, the same concept can however be applied to suppliers of the borrower. However, istijara can work with suppliers of the borrower. In this case, the bank enters into a murabaha with the suppliers on the basis of istijara. The bank enters into an agreement to purchase with the suppliers, which are mainly trading companies, that it will purchase assets from them at a market price or at a predetermined discount from the market price. Whenever the bank has a new customer, it can purchase the assets from the suppliers on the basis of istijara and sell it onwards to the customer on the basis of murabaha. It might very well be probable that the bank might enter into a pseudo-istijara agreement with the suppliers rather than a true one. This is the case when the bank enters into an agreement with the customer that it is going to sell certain assets in a certain quantity to them within a specified time period. The customer may then purchase the assets from the banks in tranches rather than at once and complete the whole purchase within the specified time period in order to complete the agreement. The above type of istijara is referred to as istijara with pre-agreed sale due to the reason that the customer purchases a given amount of assets from the bank over a period of time, but the price of the assets purchased is always known before the sale. Given the above, there is no difference of opinion between Sharia scholars as far as accepting this type of transaction as bay'at tati is concerned. However, the use of tati in case of a murabaha transaction is not acceptable, as it leads indirectly to riba in case the bank does not take possession of the assets before they are sold to the customer. Hence, if tati is to be used in this case, then the only way to do it is that the bank should purchase the assets some time before selling it to the customer. This would ensure possession that is not just constructive, but the bank would have title to the assets before they are sold to the customer. Given that the above conditions are complied with to their full extent, istijara can be used in case of a murabaha. Ijara. Leasing. Basic rules. Transferring of usufruct, not ownership. In leasing, an owner transfers its usufruct to another person for an agreed period, at an agreed consideration. Subject of lessee. Should be valuable, identified and quantified. All consumable things cannot be leased out. The corpus of the leased property remains in the ownership of the seller, and only its usufruct is transferred to the lessee. Thus, anything which cannot be used without consuming cannot be leased out. For example, money, wheat, etc. All liabilities of ownership is borne by lessor. As the corpus of the leased property remains in the ownership of the lessor, all the liabilities emerging from the ownership shall be borne by the lessor. Period of lease. The period of lease must be determined in clear terms. It is necessary for a valid lease that the leased asset is fully identified by the parties. Lease for specific purpose. The lessee cannot use the leased asset for any purpose other than the purpose specified in the lease agreement. However, if no such purpose is specified in the agreement, the lessee can use it for whatever purpose it is used in the normal course. Lessee as a mean. The lessee is liable to compensate the lessor for every harm to the leased asset caused by any misuse or negligence. The leased asset shall remain in the risk of the lessor throughout the lease period in the sense that any harm or loss caused by the factors beyond the control of the lessee shall be borne by the lessor. Lease of jointly owned property. A property jointly owned by two or more persons can be leased out, and the rental shall be distributed between all joint owners according to the proportion of their respective shares in the property. A joint owner of a property can lease his proportionate share only to his co-sharer, and not to any other person. Determination of rental. The rental must be determined at the time of contract for the whole period of lease. It is permissible that different amounts of rent are fixed for different phases during the lease period, provided that the amount of rent for each phase is specifically agreed upon at the time of effecting a lease. If the rent for a subsequent phase of the lease period has not been determined or has been left at the option of the lessor, the lease is not valid. The determination of rental on the basis of the aggregate cost incurred in the purchase of the asset by the lessor, as normally done in financial leases, is not against the rules of Sharia, if both parties agree to it, provided that all other conditions of a valid lease prescribed by the Sharia are fully adhered to. The lessor cannot increase the rent unilaterally, and any agreement to this effect is void. The rent or any part thereof may be payable in advance before the delivery of the asset to the lessee, but the amount so collected by the lessor shall remain with him as on account payment and shall be adjusted towards the rent after its being due. The lease period shall commence from the date on which the leased asset has been delivered to the lessee. If the leased asset has totally lost the function for which it was leased, the contract will stand terminated. The rentals can be used on or benchmarked with some index as well. In this case, the ceiling and floor rentals can be identified for validity of lease. Lease as a mode of financing. Lease is not originally a mode of financing. It is simply a transaction meant to transfer the usufruct of a property from one person to another for an agreed period against an agreed consideration. However, certain financial institutions have adopted leasing as a mode of financing instead of long-term lending on the basis of interest. This transaction of financial lease may be used for Islamic financing, subject to certain conditions. It is not sufficient for this purpose to substitute the name of interest by the name of rent and replace the name of mortgage by the name of leased asset. There must be a substantial difference between leasing and an interest-bearing loan. That will be possible only by following all the Islamic rules of leasing, some of which have been mentioned earlier. To be more specific, some basic differences between the contemporary financial leasing and the actual leasing allowed by the Sharia are indicated below. The commencement of lease. Unlike the contract of sale, the agreement of ijara can be effected for a future date. Hence, it is different from mura baiha. In most cases of the financial lease, the lessor, that is the financial institution, purchases the asset through the lessee himself. The lessee purchases the asset on behalf of the lessor, who pays its price to the supplier, either directly or through the lessee. In some lease agreements, the lease commences on the very day on which the price is paid by the lessor, irrespective of whether the lessee has effected payment to the supplier and taken delivery of the asset or not. It may mean that lessee's liability for the rent starts before the lessee takes delivery of the asset. This is not allowed in Sharia, because it amounts to charging rent on the money given to the customer, which is nothing but interest, pure and simple. Rent should be charged after the delivery of the leased asset. The correct way, according to Sharia, is that the rent will be charged after the lessee has taken delivery of the asset, and not from the day the price has been paid. If the supplier has delayed the delivery after receiving the full price, the lessee should not be liable for the rent of the period of delay. Different relations of the parties. It should be clearly understood that when the lessee himself has been entrusted with the purchase of the asset intended to be leased, there are two separate relations between the institution and the client, which come into operation one after the other. In the first instance, the client is an agent of the institution to purchase the asset on latter's behalf. At this stage, the relation between the parties is nothing more than the relation of a principal and his agent. The relation of lessor and lessee has not yet come into operation. The second stage begins from the date when the client takes delivery from the supplier. At this stage, the relation of lessor and lessee comes to play its role. These two capacities of the parties should not be mixed up or confused with each other. During the first stage, the client cannot be held liable for the obligations of a lessee. In this period, he is responsible to carry out the functions of an agent only. But when the asset is delivered to him, he is liable to discharge his obligations as a lessee. Difference between Murabaha and leasing. In Murabaha, as mentioned earlier, actual sale should take place after the client takes delivery from the supplier, and the previous agreement of Murabaha is not enough for effecting the actual sale. Therefore, after taking possession of the asset as an agent, he is bound to give intimation to the institution, and make an offer for the purchase from him. The sale takes place after the institution accepts the offer. The procedure in leasing is different, and a little shorter. Here the parties need not effect the lease contract after taking delivery. If the institution, while appointing the client its agent, has agreed to lease the asset with effect from the date of delivery, the lease will automatically start on that date without any additional procedure. There are two reasons for this difference between Murabaha and leasing. A. It is a necessary condition for a valid sale that it should be effected instantly. Thus, a sale attributed to a future date is invalid in Sharia. But leasing can be attributed to a future date. Therefore, the previous agreement is not sufficient in the case of Murabaha, while it is quite enough in the case of leasing. B. The basic principle of Sharia is that one cannot claim a profit or a fee for a property the risk of which was never borne by him. Applying this principle to Murabaha, the seller cannot claim a profit over a property which never remained under his risk for a moment. Therefore, if the previous agreement is held to be sufficient for effecting a sale between the client and the institution, the asset shall be transferred to the client simultaneously when he takes its possession, and the asset shall not come into the risk of the seller even for a moment. That is why the simultaneous transfer is not possible in Murabaha, and there should be a fresh offer and acceptance after the delivery. In leasing, however, the asset remains under the risk and ownership of the lessor throughout the leasing period, because the ownership has not been transferred. Therefore, if the lease period begins right from the time when the client has taken delivery, it does not violate the principle mentioned above. Expenses consequent to ownership. As the lessor is the owner of the asset and he has purchased it from the supplier through his agent, he is liable to pay all the expenses incurred in the process of its purchase and its import to the country of the lessor, for example expenses of freight and customs duty etc. He can, of course, include all these expenses in his cost and can take them into consideration while fixing the rentals, but as a matter of principle, he is liable to bear all these expenses as the owner of the asset. Any agreement to the contrary, as is found in the traditional financial leases, is not in conformity with Sharia. Lessee is a mean, liability of the parties in case of loss to the asset. As mentioned in the basic principles of leasing, the lessee is responsible for any loss caused to the asset by his misuse or negligence. He can also be made liable to the wear and tear, which normally occurs during its use. But he cannot be made liable to a loss caused by the factors beyond his control. The agreements of the traditional financial lease generally do not differentiate between the two situations. In a lease based on the Islamic principles, both the situations should be dealt with separately. Variable rentals in long-term leases. In the long-term lease agreements, it is mostly not in the benefit of the lessor to fix one amount of rent for the whole period of lease, because the market conditions change from time to time. In this case, the lessor has two options. A. He can contract lease with a condition that the rent shall be increased according to a specified proportion, example 5%, after a specified period, like 1 year. B. He can contract lease for a shorter period, after which the parties can renew the lease at new terms and by mutual consent, with full liberty to each one of them to refuse the renewal, in which case the lessee is bound to vacate the leased property and return it back to the lessor. These two options are available to the lessor according to the classical rules of Islamic fiqh. However, some contemporary scholars have allowed, in long-term leases, to tie up the rental amount with a variable benchmark, which is so well known and well defined that it does not leave room for any dispute. For example, it is permissible according to them to provide in the lease contract that in case of any increase in the taxes imposed by the government on the lessor, the rent will be increased to the extent of same amount. Similarly, it is allowed by them that the annual increase in the rent is tied up with the rate of inflation. Therefore, if there is an increase of 5% in the rate of inflation, it will result in an increase of 5% in the rent as well. Based on the same principle, some Islamic banks use the rate of interest as a benchmark to determine the rental amounts. They want to earn the same profit through leasing as is earned by the conventional banks through advancing loans on the basis of interest. Therefore, they want to tie up the rentals with the rate of interest, and instead of fixing a definite amount of rental, they calculate the cost of purchasing the lease assets and want to earn through rentals an amount equal to the rate of interest. Therefore, the agreement provides that the rental will be equal to the rate of interest or to the rate of interest plus something. Since the rate of interest is variable, it cannot be determined for the whole lease period. Therefore, these contracts use the interest rate of a particular country, like LIBOR, as a benchmark for determining the periodical increase in the rent. This arrangement has been criticized on two grounds. A. The first objection raised against it is that, by subjecting the rental payments to the rate of interest, the transaction is rendered akin to an interest-based financing. This objection can be overcome by saying that, as fully discussed in the case of Murabaha, the rate of interest is used as a benchmark only. So far as other requirements of Sharia for a valid lease are properly fulfilled, the contract may use any benchmark for determining the amount of rental. The basic difference between an interest-based financing and a valid lease does not lie in the amount to be paid to the financier or the lessor. The basic difference is that in the case of lease, the lessor assumes the full risk of the corpus of the leased asset. If the asset is destroyed during the lease period, the lessor will suffer the loss. Similarly, if the leased asset loses its usufruct without any misuse or negligence on the part of the lessee, the lessor cannot claim the rent, while in the case of an interest-based financing, the financier is entitled to receive interest, even if the debtor did not at all benefit from the money borrowed. So far as this basic difference is maintained, that is, the lessor assumes the risk of the leased asset, the transaction cannot be categorized as an interest-bearing transaction, even though the amount of rent claimed from the lessee is equal to the rate of interest. It is thus clear that the use of the rate of interest merely as a benchmark does not render the contract invalid as an interest-based transaction. It is, however, advisable at all times to avoid using interest even as a benchmark, so that an Islamic transaction is totally distinguished from an un-Islamic one, having no resemblance of interest whatsoever. B. The second objection to this arrangement is that the variations of the rate of interest being unknown, the rental tied up with the rate of interest will imply jahala and gara, which is not permissible in Sharia. It is one of the basic requirements of Sharia that the parties must know the consideration in every contract when they enter into it. The consideration in a transaction of lease is the rent charged from the lessee, and therefore it must be known to each party right at the beginning of the contract of lease. If we tie up the rental with the future rate of interest, which is unknown, the amount of rent will remain unknown as well. This is the jahala or gara, which renders the transaction invalid. Responding to this objection, one may say that the jahala has been prohibited for two reasons. It may lead to dispute between the parties. This reason is not applicable here, because both parties have agreed with mutual consent upon a well-defined benchmark that will serve as a criterion for determining the rent, and whatever amount is determined, based on this benchmark, will be acceptable to both parties. Therefore, there is no question of any dispute between them. Continued in Part 5. Compiled by Hussein Fahmy.